Check, one, two, check. Check, check, one, two, check.
Check. Hello everyone, good morning and welcome to New City Fellowship. Let me invite you to please find your seats. If you're joining us for the first time as a guest, a visitor, or you're here and this is entirely new, this is your first time coming to a worship service, we are so glad to have you and so glad you're with us. And I trust this time would be really a blessing for all of us. Everything you need to follow along in the service will be displayed on the screen behind me. And it can also be found on the Rhythms of Grace, our worship bulletin. If you haven't received a copy, you can go to the welcome desk and grab one to keep with you and follow along through the service. Let's take the next few moments in silence to pause and to prepare our hearts to meet God in worship. We'll take a few minutes and we'll get started. For those of you who have just walked in, welcome to NCF. Glad to have you. Let me begin our service with a brief thought. So in scripture, we are told that if we are a Christian, we are given a new identity and a new citizenship in God's kingdom. And what that means is we are strangers in this world. And there are three ways in which we can live as strangers, belonging to a different kingdom, but living in a different kingdom. And the first way is to live as aliens, where we resent all the differences in our host country that's different from our home country. And we say things like, I feel trapped, I feel stuck, I feel isolated. We feel like we are in a place brought here against our own will. And what that does is that these distinctions that we see, these differences we see, sort of leads us to anger or fear. And the second approach is to live as visitors or backpackers, where we go into a host culture and we are curious about the culture and about all that's happening there, but we are disengaged. We have no real investment of our lives in that particular culture. And so we always say things like, I miss home. I'm just going to be here. I'm going to take all these differences in curiously, but I'm not going to fix roots in here because I'm going to return home soon. I'm just a visitor here. And the third way is to live as ambassadors. And these are people who miss home. They're loyal to their home country, but they're not resentful like the aliens, or they're not disengaged like the backpackers or visitors. They are positively focused on the culture that they find themselves in, that they intentionally live as strangers purposefully. They want to represent the king and the values of their home country in the host culture that they find themselves in. And that's what we are called to as Christians, live as ambassadors. Individually, as ambassadors in our home, in our families, in our communities, but also the church itself plays a role of an ambassador, representing a foreign culture and foreign values in the culture that we find ourselves in. So with that preparatory thought, let me invite you to stand as we are called to worship a God who sends us out into the city as ambassadors. Please follow along as we read in our call to worship in page 3 responsively. Remember, at one time we were separated from Christ, excluded from citizenship in Israel, and foreigners to the covenant of the promise, without hope and without God in the world. But now in Christ Jesus, we who once were far away have been brought near through the blood of Christ together. For you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people belonging to God, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. Come, let us worship the Lord together. Please remain standing for our first song.
Check. Good morning, church. Come, let us worship and declare the praises of him who called us out of the darkness into his wonderful light. Let us praise him in singing.
Oh, come behold the works of God, the nations at his feet. He breaks the bow and bends the spear and tells the wars to cease. Oh, mighty one of Israel, you are on our side. We walk by faith in God who burns the chariots with fire. Lord of hosts, you're with us in the fire, with us as a shelter, with us in the storm. You will lead us through the fiercest battle. Oh, where else would we go with the Lord of hosts? Oh, God of Jacob, fierce and great, you lift your voice to speak. The earth, it bows, and all the mountains move into the sea. Oh Lord, you know the hearts of men, and say you let them live. Oh God, who makes the mountains melt, come wrestle us and breathe. Oh God, who makes the mountains melt, come wrestle us and win. Lord of hosts, you're with us in the fire, with us as a shelter, with us in the storm. The oceans roar, you are the Lord of all, the one who calms the wind and waves and makes my heart be still. Though the earth gives way, the mountains move into the sea, the nations rage, I know my God is in control. The oceans roar, you are the Lord of all, the one who calms the wind and waves and makes my heart be still. Though the earth gives way, the mountains move into the sea, the nations rage, I know my God is in control. The Lord of hosts, you're with us in the fire, with us as a shelter, with us in the storm. You will lead us through the fiercest battle. Oh, where else would we go with the Lord of hosts?
Yahweh Sabaoth, the Lord of hosts, you are strong and mighty. O Lord, you are mighty in battle. You are the King of glory. Kingship belongs to you, O Lord, and you rule over nations. Yahweh, you are sovereign over it all. You govern the nation and appoint the rulers, and there is nothing that is not under your control. Lord, you are working everything to the praise of your glory and for our good. There is none like you, O Lord. You are great, and your name is great in might. Your name is majestic and is greatly to be praised and adored. Jesus, you won the battle against death, and you have been given a name that is above every other name. And at your name, every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is the Lord for the glory of God. We worship you and adore you this morning. To him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be blessing and honor and glory and might forever and ever. Amen.
You are the Word at the beginning, one with God, the Lord Most High. Your hidden glory in creation, now revealed in you are Christ. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is. The name of You died upon the cross to save us, to reconcile us back to God. My sin was great, your love was greater. What could separate us now? What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a wonderful name it is, nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ. What a wonderful name it is, the name of Jesus. Praise of your glory, for you are raised to life again. You have no rival, you have no equal, now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the King. Yours is the glory, yours is the name above all names. What a powerful name it is, what a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ my King. What a powerful name it is, nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of
Friends, you may be seated. We now come to a time of confession. And one of the lines in the song that we just sang resonated with me. It says, my sin was great, but your love was greater. And that's what we acknowledge and affirm in this time of confession each week, where we say, my sin is great, my offense against God is great, my failures, my shortcomings are great, but we also acknowledge and affirm that his love, his compassion, his kindness, his intentions for his people is much greater and bigger than what our sin can hold against us. And so we are essentially saying our sin is great, but Christ is greater. And that's the affirmation that we make each week in this time of confession. So let me invite you to consider your sin, but also to consider the love of Christ and to take your sins to him, knowing that when you bring your sins to him, he will not shame us, he will not scold us, he'll not raise his eyebrow and scoff at us. Instead, he will, in compassion, forgive us. So with that in mind, let's turn to page 5 and we'll confess our sins together. O Lord, we have not longed for your coming and your kingdom as we ought. We have not denied ourselves, taken up the cross, and followed you. Instead, clinging to the things of this world and counting them dear, we have grown callous to the needs of the poor, the lonely, the suffering. We have not cried out for justice, nor cared about those who are without Christ and without hope in this world. Lord, forgive us for our offenses, and grant that by the power of your Spirit, we might live in light of your coming again. Amen. Let's take a few moments now in silence and in humility and bring our personal, private, and specific sins before God, knowing that the one who hears our prayers of confession is a God who is just and who is merciful. Let's take a few minutes. In your mercy, would you hear our confessions to you? Amen. Friends, for all those who have turned from your sin and turned to Christ and placed your hope and faith in His love alone, hear God speak to you and assure your hearts of His love. From 1 John 2, verses 1 to 2. My dear children, I write this to you so that you will not sin. But if anybody does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. He is the atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not only for ours, but also for the sins of the whole world. Rejoice, in Jesus Christ we are forgiven. God's people respond, thanks be to God, amen. We now move into a time of offertory, and here we have an opportunity to think about how we might offer up our whole selves to God, but also how we might offer up our resources to further His mission as ambassadors in this city. And so particularly we bring our financial resources to Him. If you're a member and a believer, you're welcome to give, but if you're a first-time visitor, not yet a follower of Christ, feel no obligation to give. Listen to the music, reflect on the lyrics, but the rest of us, let us all stand and celebrate this act of giving cheerfully.
Church, let us all rise as we sing this song, Let the Nations Be Glad. Let the glory of the Lord may forever be our joy. May redemption be the theme of our song. For by grace we have been saved, and by grace we shall proclaim to the corners of the earth that Christ has come. Let the nations be glad, let the people rejoice, for salvation belongs to our God. Let the whole earth be filled with the praises of the Lord, for salvation belongs to our God. Let the nations be ages gone before, through the trial and the sword, many saints and martyrs conquered, though they died. Still we holding out the cross, crossing oceans, suffering loss, shall endure all things to win the crown of life. Let the nations be glad, let the people rejoice, for salvation belongs to our God. Let the whole earth be filled with the praises of the Lord, for salvation belongs to our God. Let the nations be as your holy church goes forth in the Holy Spirit's power, with the glory of the gospel to exclaim. Now we pray your kingdom come, and we pray your will be done, for the honor and the glory of your name. Let the nations be glad, let the people rejoice, for salvation belongs to our God. Let the whole earth be filled with the praises of the Lord, for salvation belongs
be glad. Let the people rejoice, for salvation belongs to our God. Let the whole earth be filled with the praises of the Lord, for salvation belongs to our God. Let the nations be glad.
Please be seated. Good morning again. My name is David. I'm one of the ruling elders over here. Welcome to this morning's worship service, Lord's Day service. Children are now dismissed. Aunties Andrea and Elsa will take care of them today. Thank you, ladies. Children between the ages of 4 and 9 will meet right over there. If you're here for the first time, or maybe after a very long time, a blue card may have been given to you. Please make sure you fill it out, a couple of details about yourself, and hand it to Hansel or to Jesswin so that we can know how to pray for you, how to reach out to you, and how to care for you while you're here. I hope you're enjoying the week-on-week sermon on the Mount. If you've missed any of the sermons, it's all on YouTube. You can binge watch it today. It's bittersweet. But this Sunday will be the last week that we meet at Versus. What this means is, given our city-centered desire to be a city-centered church to minister. In that sense, we are moving back to the center of Bangalore. We will meet from the week after next at Nahar Hotel. We will, of course, send you all the details, all the links, the Google Maps location and everything. Many of you know of this place, especially if you even came to the Christmas service. Those who don't know where this place is, information will come to you on the WhatsApp channel. Or if you're not on the WhatsApp group yet, please keep in touch with somebody who's a regular over here. I know this is. Some of you will be deliriously happy that we're moving back to Nahar. For some people, it's hard news. So be sensitive while you're talking about that. Next week is the retreat. So we're not meeting here or at Nahar. We're meeting at the retreat center. So did somebody say retreat? Yeah. Thank you for the overwhelmingly amazing response to the retreat. We have lots of people coming to the retreat. We have, 110 people coming. Thank you, Jesswin, for coordinating all of it. And I know he's got people on his team. There's one handsome single guy named Paul Gideon back there who's also part of the team. More information on when to be there, what time to get there, how the thing will proceed, the schedule, all that will come during the week. But from all the information you have, please try to be there by 4 o'clock. It's a Friday, it's working day, so even if you're a little late, do come. Just make it. And Sunday service will be at Glorious Promised Land. I always struggle with that. I don't know why. Glorious Promised Land. And so if you're not coming to the retreat, you are encouraged to come join us at Glorious Promised Land. Yeah, okay. All right. I think the only thing I missed was while we're meeting at Nahar from the week after next onwards, we are grateful for Versus and for this provision and to pray for that and for other things. Would you join me in prayer now? Our loving Father, our God, We are thankful to be in your presence this morning. As a church ransomed and redeemed by your Son, Jesus, we come only by the privilege of Christ's blessed sacrifice that puts us in good standing, that allows us to be in your presence. As a congregation, we draw near to you, God, asking the Holy Spirit to help reorient our hearts to worship and to the ministry of the word this morning. Father, this morning, as we pray for our hearts to be reoriented, for faith, for diligence to pursue your word, for courage that comes only from the gospel, give us eyes to see the needs of this world. And Father, this morning we pray especially for Turkey and Syria and other regions that are devastated by the earthquake. Would you move the hearts and minds of the peoples of this world to reach out in urgency and meaningful care? Would you move our hearts to serve? Would you show us how to care for the grieving, those who have lost everything earthly in a few seconds? Everything turned to crushed bodies and rubble. Father, would you help us? Father, we pray for heightened tensions and war between countries, so many of them at loggerheads. We pray for calm to be restored. We pray for war zones to be silenced and peace to be restored. Father, while we still say, Jesus, come soon, we also pray for the unrepentant and stubborn aggressors to be dealt with justice and a return of peace. Father, we pray for peace within our country as we watch the rising strength of radicalism and increased fundamentalism. We experience fear for minorities such as ourselves. Would you help us still pray for our aggressors and for their hearts to be truly transformed by the gospel, the only true and lasting way that change can happen in their hearts? Would you protect the lives of those who are most vulnerable to the violence meted out by polarized sections of society? Father, we pray for the underrepresented in this country, whether it is by the caste system or by economic disparities or by ethnicities. We pray for protection and comfort to those whose voices are always suppressed. Father, we pray for our city, for Nama City, Bangalore. Thank you for placing us here, and wherever you have placed us, would you give us courage and wisdom to speak the gospel? Would you help us to be active ambassadors in your service? Would you help us prioritize the gospel reaching our colleague, our neighbor, our college mate? Would you help us prioritize that gospel reaching them over our own comfort, over our own desires, and over our own entertainment? Father, we pray for the churches of Bangalore to unite under the banner of gospel outreach, to have a strong, vocal gospel influence in the city, to have a voice that is heard, heeded to, and actioned upon. You have placed us here, Father, to fulfill the great commission that Jesus gave us. So even as we thank you and are grateful for where you have placed us, we are thankful for this space, for Versus, for the business. Father, we pray that you will bless Versus as a business and continue to help us use this space well for your kingdom and for your glory. And Father, we pray in anticipation for the provision of Nahar and that place, that hotel where we have met for years now. Father, thank you for your always looking out for us. Father, help us to, even as we move back to Nahar, that it may be, it may continue to bear fruit through the city-centered vision that New City Fellowship has had in the city of Bangalore. Holy Spirit, bring your word to us through Philip. Open our hearts to receive the ministry of the word well. Would you soothe us? Would you calm us, make us attentive, and encourage us and build us up to the works of proclaiming good news to the whole world, starting with our neighbor. Father, we're also grateful for the measure of healing that you have given Rafa. Father, would you continue to restore him to health, and would you continue to help us come around this family in loving care and community. We thank you, we praise you, and we ask all this in Jesus' most precious name. Amen. May I invite Paul to come read the word to us?
Church, if you're willing and able, would you stand for the reading of God's word? Today's scripture text is taken from Matthew chapter 10, verses 1 until verse 25. You can follow it in the ROG. And he called to him his 12 disciples and gave them authority over unclean spirits, to cast them out and to heal every disease and every affliction. The names of the 12 apostles are these: first, Simon, who is called Peter, and Andrew his brother, James the son of Zebedee, and John his brother, Philip and Bartholomew, Thomas and Matthew the tax collector, James the son of Alphaeus and Thaddeus, Simon the zealot, and Judas Iscariot, who betrayed him. These 12 Jesus sent out, instructing them, "Go nowhere among the Gentiles and enter no town of the Samaritans, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel, and proclaim as you go, saying, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse lepers, cast out demons. You received without paying, give without pay. Acquire no gold or silver or copper for your belts, no bag for your journey, or two tunics, or sandals, or a staff. For the laborer deserves his food. And whatever town or village you enter, find out who is worthy in it and stay there until you depart. As you enter the house, greet it. And if the house is worthy, let your peace come upon it. But if it is not worthy, let your peace return to you. And if anyone will not receive you or listen to your words, shake off the dust from your feet when you leave the house or town. Truly, I say to you, it will be more bearable on the day of judgment for the land of Sodom and Gomorrah than for that town. Behold, I am sending you out as sheep in the midst of wolves. So be wise as serpents and innocent as doves. Beware of men, for they will deliver you over to courts and flog you in their synagogues. And you will be dragged before governors and kings for my sake, to bear witness before them and the Gentiles. When they deliver you over, do not be anxious how you are to speak or what you are to say, for what you are to say will be given to you in that hour. For it is not you who speak, but the Spirit of your Father speaking through you. Brother will deliver brother over to death, and the father his child, and children will rise against parents and have them put to death. And you will be hated by all for my name's sake, but the one who endures to the end will be saved. And when they persecute you in one town, flee to the next, for truly I say to you, you will not have gone through all the towns of Israel before the Son of Man comes. A disciple is not above his teacher, nor a servant above his master. It is enough for the disciple to be like his teacher, and the servant like his master. If they have called the master of the house Beelzebul, how much more will they malign those of his household?" This is Lord's holy word.
Good morning, friends. Let's turn to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, you are the King of the world. So we need to hear your word to live our lives with purpose and beauty. And today, as we hear your word preached, Lord, I pray that you bring such purpose and beauty into our lives like never before. To that end, we commit ourselves to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Friends, please be seated. I'm Philip. I'm one of the pastors of New City Fellowship, and I'm so glad you're worshiping here with us this morning. We are a gospel-centered church in this city, and we are eager to see the gospel bring tremendous hope and joy to our fellow Bangaloreans. That's why we are here. If you're here for the first time worshiping with us, a warm welcome to you, and hope this service will help you encounter Jesus more closely here. So with that, let me introduce the passage and the sermon subject to you. Have you ever had a moment when it suddenly dawned on you that now you got to be and act more mature? Yeah, we all remember that, right? The feeling of that feeling when you feel like the responsibility of the whole world is on your shoulders, and you just can't mess it up. And at that moment, your adrenaline rushes in your veins, and your mind is awake and alert, and you're paying attention to everything that's going in your mind, in your body, and in your surroundings. Everything in the world seems to just align itself to your thought process and the responsibility that you're facing at that moment. That is an amazing experience, but a scary one. I remember about 5 years ago seeing my own baby, Elijah. He was born right outside the birthing room. And I have no idea what happened to all that sleepless night. My mind was just awake when I saw him. It's not just the joy of seeing this baby and thinking, wow, how sweet, how cute. No, it's the fear. Fear that I'm a father now. And this is a baby boy who is most likely to imbibe my patterns, including my sin patterns. And I'm like, whoa, I got to get my act together. I need to grow up all of a sudden and be the father that I was never before. The only prayer that I remember from that time was, Lord, have mercy. Have mercy on me. As we look at today's passage, the disciples had something of a similar experience. They were perhaps just about learning to get along with each other. Remember, a few of them were former colleagues. And when it's colleagues, it's not always neutral, right? You know that there are some guys who are your favorites that you get along with. There are some that you really don't like. They are quite obnoxious. So you just have to put up with them, and you move to a new office and these guys follow you. That's the worst thing. It's like, why do you not leave me? Can't I cast you out? These are a bunch of ex-colleagues. And to add to the complication, there were people who were naturally enemies from before. There was a zealot who was vehemently opposed to the Roman government and its representatives. He would find anyone who is perhaps on the side of the government. He wouldn't miss a chance to like take his life and make a point to the Roman government. Simon the Zealot. And then on the other hand, you have a tax collector who is a representative of the government, and who oppressively so. He would oppress the people in order to gain an extra point, a brownie point with the government. So that is the kind of setting, and these two guys, I have no idea how they ever got well together, if not for Jesus doing some spell on them and saying, guys, you have to now learn to love each other, right? So this is the bunch of guys who are perhaps still figuring out life together with each other, like traveling together, doing life together, and all of that. And in the midst of all of this, Jesus is making this world-changing announcement to them. He's telling them that now I'm the king of this whole world, and you guys and me, we're going to go out and change the world. They're up mid-dream. And they're like, what just happened? Did you say we're going to change the world? Let's first change ourselves. That was the scene. And now these guys need to figure out how this whole thing is going to pan out. So they need to first figure out what is it that Jesus is calling them to? What is this commission that Jesus is giving us? And then they need to figure out what it will cost them, what it will take of them, the cost of the commission. And then they need to also figure out where will our confidence come from? How will we ever accomplish this? There are so many emperors who have gone out there into the world and said, we will conquer the world, and nearly all of them failed. There are some, of course, who nearly succeeded, but with huge military strength. Look at us, 12 guys who struggled to get along with each other. So what is the commission that they got? What is the cost of this commission? And thirdly, what is the confidence that the disciples had to accomplish this commission that was given to them? First, we should recognize that the commission that they've received is very specifically to them. First and foremost, it is to them. Jesus gives the commission to them in verse 1 and verses 5 to 15. And this is very unique to the apostles, the people who are called apostles. We shouldn't hear this commission as coming to us directly, verbatim. And that's because the commission that Jesus is giving them is a very unique one. It is very specific to these 12 people. It's very specific for the time period in which they lived. That fits into the larger scheme of God's redemptive history. So we need to first listen to this commission as coming to these 12. But it does not end there. It also speaks to us, and we'll consider that as well. Let me show you why we need to consider this first as a commission coming to these 12. Because verse 1 tells us that Jesus was speaking to the 12. Right? It says, and he called to him his 12 disciples and gave them authority to do this, this, and this. Right? So he was speaking to the 12. And then verse 1 and verse 8 tell us that he gave them the authority to heal every disease and every affliction. And verse 8 tells us that he called them to heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers, cast out demons. Now, if we think that this is for us, we need to be doing all of this. And some of you might be thinking, yeah, exactly. You need to be doing that. Why aren't you doing that? Let me show you why it is very specific to them. It's not just because they were called to do these things, but also Jesus gave them a very specific instruction about how they got to go about doing it. Okay, he said verse 9, Jesus says, acquire no gold or silver, not even a bag or a staff. Don't take anything. Don't acquire anything for yourself, but just go about doing this. So if you are acquiring any gold or silver, then that means that this is not for you. Okay? And this is very specific to the apostles, that they were supposed to do it in such and such way. Okay? Now, you might be saying, Philip, you might be getting it wrong, because why not do that? Just leave all gold, silver, and bags and staff. I mean, we don't need to carry a staff. We just need a phone. Jesus didn't say don't take a phone. So we can go and get it, right? But then come back to verse 6, and Jesus says, go only to the lost sheep of Israel. Now that we know is definitely not for us. Because at the end of Matthew's gospel, Jesus says very particularly to even his disciples and the rest of the disciples that are to be added to his body, that we are to go into all the world, to all nations, and preach the gospel to the ends of the earth, that we are supposed to carry the gospel. So, first and foremost, we need to hear this specific commission as coming specifically to the disciples of Jesus, to those who are called the apostles, the sent ones. And why is it... Why did this specific commission come to these people? It is because it has a context in the history of Israel and in the history of the Old Testament. Okay, so Matthew actually makes that clear in the next chapter. In chapter 11, One of the first things that you notice is that John the Baptizer, Jesus' cousin who prepared the way for Jesus, he sends a bunch of guys to Jesus and says, and asks him, are you the Messiah who is supposed to come? And Jesus doesn't say yes. You know what he says? Go back and tell John what you see. That the blind receive their sight, the lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, the deaf hear, and the dead are raised up. What's he saying? He's not just saying, hey, look at me, I'm having these crusades where like thousands and thousands of people are getting healed. That's not what he's saying. He's saying, he's reminding John of the promises of the Old Testament. Say, for example, in Isaiah chapter 61, there is amazing promises of what is going to happen when the Messiah of God will come into this world. And what's going to happen? All these things, all these signs will act as signposts pointing to Jesus and saying, hey, this is the Messiah. This is the good king that Israel has always been waiting for. This is the king from above who's going to set all things right in a world that is broken and hopeless. So that is what these miracles indicated. And that is why Jesus gives these miracles to be performed by his disciples in that season, because that is a season where all signposts need to point to Jesus and say, this is the king who has come as the Messiah of this world. And that is a very, very specific purpose. And this purpose was very specific to Israel. Because Israel was the one who was supposed to see this as a Messiah that was promised to them. And when Israel sees it, when the gospel first reaches Israel, then it will go forth into the nations. And that is and that's the plan that you see unfold in the rest of the New Testament. Romans chapter 1, verse 16, Paul says that the gospel is God's power, and it's first to the Jews and then to the Gentiles, because the Jews need to first recognize him as the Messiah, and then the rest of the world will also recognize him as the Messiah, and hope will flow out of Israel into the nations. So that is the purpose for which Jesus is sending his disciples out. At this point, he's sending them out to proclaim to the land of Israel that the Messiah has come, and to evidence that with signs and wonders. Signs are signposts that point to the reality, and they need to point to Jesus. But remember that when Jesus commission, he's not just giving it so that we hear it and say, okay, that is not for me. Jesus is giving this commission to them for us. And there are certain patterns that you notice within this commission that are very much applicable to you and me as we witness the name of Jesus Christ in the city of Bangalore in 2023. There are certain tensions that you see arise within the text, within Jesus' speech, that will be very instructive to us in how we are going to witness to the world that is around us, to 21st century Bangalore, to 21st century India, to the 21st century world. Let me show you three tensions here that are very instructive to how we are going to carry out the mission of Jesus Christ in the midst of brokenness. The first tension, the message of God's kingdom both restores the world and rebukes the world. It both restores the world and rebukes the world. Look at that. As the apostles heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse lepers, and cast out demons, verse 8, they are essentially bringing peace to the place that they enter, verse 13. Now, how does peace go with like casting out demons and all these things, healing the sick and all of that they're doing? The Hebrew word peace is shalom, which is part of an Israelite greeting to one another, shalom aleichem, from where the Arabic Salam Aleikum comes. Shalom Aleikum, peace be upon you. It's a very, very profound word in the whole of the Old Testament. Shalom does not just mean tranquility or lack of conflict. The Hebrew idea of peace is about restoring wholeness to every broken part of our being. Which means that what is broken, what is sinful, what is bad in our world will be taken away from the scene, and that which is good will be nurtured, it will flourish, all of us will become whole, and everything around us will become beautiful. That is the idea of shalom. Now you may be thinking that that's very utopian, right? The interesting part is God does not discount this utopia, because this is a true utopia. Because this is a promise that's been given by God himself that he will actually make this happen. So when the disciples of Jesus Christ went and proclaimed peace, what they are essentially doing is that they are wishing that all of God's wholeness will come into this community and will transform them. That is the good news. As a sign of that, they're going to do all these miracles, all these signs that the apostles were asked to perform. But this does not mean that the preaching of the gospel will melt all people into tears of gratitude. How amazing that you are restoring, you're making the world a better place. What an amazing thing. That's not what it's going to do. Jesus reminded them that this is going to have consequences. But before we go into the consequences of that, what does this proclamation of shalom mean to us as we testify to the gospel of Jesus Christ? It means that although we may not be accompanied by apostolic signs in our witness to the world around us, there is something that God is going to do even as we witness. God uses those gifts that he has given us. God uses those abilities that he has given us in order to bring some degree of shalom into the world that is broken. That means that he gives us the boldness to use our life, our seasons of life, and the work that he has given us, and the relationships that he has given us, he will enable all these good things to bring redemption into this world. That means that he will give us the boldness to bring dignity to the undignified. He'll give us boldness to defend the bullied. He'll give us the abilities within this community to nurse the physical and emotional hurts of people with the gospel of Jesus Christ. And that is what he's going to do even with us. That he is indeed bringing peace. He is indeed bringing shalom through what he calls you and me to do. But that does not mean that both in the time of the apostles and in the time in which we witness to the gospel, that people will just embrace the gospel with open arms. There will be people who will reject the gospel. And Jesus is very, very realistic. He puts it out there for us to see and to know that there will be people who will reject the gospel of Jesus Christ. And Jesus, while instructing the disciples, he tells them that even the children of Israel will reject the gospel. And the instructions that he gives them are pretty interesting. He says that when the people of Israel reject the gospel that you preach to them, this is what you need to do. You need to shake the dust off your feet in their homes or in their towns and move on. Now you wonder, what is this shaking of the dust? It sounds like a dance step, but it's not. Because this is a practice that was part of the Israelite history. The pious men of Israel, when they entered the Gentile territory, or the non-Jewish territory, or the Samaritan territory, what they would do is, while they were leaving, they would shake the dust off their feet. And that is their way of telling them, you are the outsiders, we are the insiders. And see what Jesus is doing with the people of Israel. He's telling his disciples to shake the feet off their dust. Sorry, their dust are of, the feet are of dust as well. to shake the dust off their feet in the towns that reject the gospel. What are they saying? He's saying that this will be a testimony to them that they are the outsiders and not the insiders. Isn't it crazy that the insiders become outsiders because they reject the gospel of Jesus Christ? And that, there's a greater shocking statement that Jesus makes in verse 15. He says that it will be more bearable on the day of judgment for the land of Sodom and Gomorrah than for that town. You remember the story of Sodom and Gomorrah? What happened? They rejected God. They blatantly sinned against God's nature. And God just destroyed the two cities. The little display of God's judgment on sin and rebellion right at the beginning of human history. And Jesus is saying that for Sodom and Gomorrah, it'll be more bearable on that day than those who reject the gospel of Jesus Christ. Why so? It's because to those, more is given, more will be expected of them. To those, the gospel of Jesus Christ is given, it is expected that they respond in repentance. And Jesus says that without that, judgment is certain. And that's really the scary part of what I'm doing today. I am preaching the gospel to you. To whom more is given, more will be expected of them. And it's scary to me, because to whom more is given, from them more will be expected. Unless our hearts turn in repentance to this gospel of Jesus Christ, unless we, there is no hope. And Jesus is not mincing words here. And he expects the disciples of Jesus also to not mince words. He's saying that that the gospel is it both restores, but it also brings a rebuke. Those who reject the gospel, and that needs to be part of our proclamation of the gospel as well. That we call people to repentance and bring the rebuke of the gospel in the face of rejection of the gospel. Warn people to turn to Jesus, something that we are often afraid of doing. And Jesus calls that to be a part of our mission, to bring both the restoration of the gospel and also the rebuke of the gospel to the world. Then comes the second tension. The proclamation of the gospel needs to be both in word and deed. Look at verses 7 and 8. Proclaim as you go, saying, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse lepers, cast out demons. Do you see how this mission both includes proclamation, that is, saying it verbally, and also in physical action? We regularly come across churches that either miss one or the other. The neglect of social action reduces our message to irrelevance, since people won't get to see the tangible power of the gospel at work, then what are you preaching? Where's the power? You say all these great things. Does this even have power in my life, in my realities? On the other hand, the neglect of the proclamation reduces us to mere social workers who have no hope to offer that is supernatural. We'll do everything that's within our power, but there is no place for the supernatural because you're not proclaiming the Jesus who will heal the land. The Jesus who whose name there is salvation. There is complete shalom in his name. If you do not proclaim that, then there is no hope that is beyond what human effort can achieve. And human efforts have achieved some. Praise God for that. But it hasn't achieved all of it because it's beyond us. The gospel brings the power of Jesus Christ, of God into the world. So proclamation and action should go hand in hand. And as we proclaim this, think of how this acted out in the lives of the disciples. As these ambassadors were proclaiming the gospel, they were bound to have compassion like Jesus did. Actually, there's an interesting bit that I want to draw your attention to here. Before Jesus sent the 12 disciples, towards the end of chapter 9 of Matthew, this is what's happening. Jesus looked at the people and he had compassion on them. He saw that they were like sheep without a shepherd. He saw that they were helpless and harassed. And so he said, pray to the Lord of the harvest that he will send workers into the field to bring the good news. And what does Jesus do immediately? He sends the 12. He sends you and me. He has compassion. His compassionate heart is turned towards them, looking at them as sheep that is without shepherd, that needs care, that needs the truth, that needs utmost care. And Jesus, when he sends you and me out, unless our mission and our heart is characterized by the compassion of Jesus, we are missing out on the essence of the gospel. So how did it play out in the lives of the disciples? They were supposed to cleanse the lepers. And that is not just healing a physical ailment. Cleansing the lepers, you know how Jesus did? He went, touched them, and then said, be clean. And that was huge in the story of Israel because they ostracized the lepers. The lepers were the untouchable. So what Jesus is calling these disciples to do is to touch the untouchable, dignify them, and pray for God's healing upon them so that they may be restored. What a powerful call that he's giving to the disciples and saying that now by the power of the gospel, the untouchable will become dignified. The ostracized will be served. Now think of this. As we proclaim the gospel, that's essentially what we would be doing as well. Restoring the unwanted and the undignified. It's going to be hard. For example, try inviting a hijra on the streets into your home and treat them with dignity. It'll make you very uncomfortable and it's scary. Trust me, I tried it. But that's how the mission of Jesus looks. It will take you into places of discomfort and fear. But Jesus, when the proclamation and the deed go together, he is going to usher in his kingdom into places that are so broken that the world will only look away from those places. The disciples of Jesus are going to restore them with the gospel. Word and deed go together. Now the third tension, the logistical one. Verses 9 and 10, Jesus tells his disciples not to acquire gold or silver or copper, nor a bag or two tunics or sandals or a staff for their journey. He then says an interesting thing after that. He says, the laborer deserves his food. What is Jesus getting at? He's saying, look, money and provisions are essential for any ministry, for any mission. But the gospel ministry cannot be used for gaining a luxurious living. There is money that's needed, but the gospel ministry cannot be used for gaining just a luxurious living. And this is an important thing, and I want you to be thinking about this, be thinking about the implications of this for us today. As we've heard about NCF moving back to the city center, and serving out of there and reaching the city at large, all the various places in the city, with the vision of planting churches across the city where the gospel of Jesus Christ can freely flow. And as we think of planting a congregation here in the north, it all costs money. Why do you do that if it costs money? Because this money God has given us. How did He give us? He gave it to us through you, through me and you. What's He saying? That the mission of God, the laborer deserves his wages. Which means that it'll cost us to do the mission of Jesus. So this is an encouragement for those who are receiving the ministry of the gospel to generously give. And frankly, I'm immensely grateful. The elders are immensely grateful for the kind of giving that we have witnessed in the past 2 months, even in the rest of the year, but particularly in the past 2 months. This goes towards the mission of Jesus Christ, to the furtherance of the gospel, both in word and deed, in our city. But here is something that I'd also like to highlight. Often, this happens by the generous giving of a few. And my friend, this is not about asking you to make the pastors of NCF rich or to make NCF rich. No, it's not about that. But it's a call to genuinely participate in the ministry of Jesus Christ through tangible giving of your financial resources. And even your other resources. May I encourage you to that? But having said that, Jesus also tells us that the ministers of the gospel, whoever they may be, at whichever point in time they may be living, they cannot make the ministry of the gospel as a source to get rich. Now, that can be very subjective, but the motive of the hearts will be judged by the King of the universe. So no one can use these resources to just get rich. And that's a huge warning. And our ministry needs to be characterized both by generosity and simplicity. That's how Jesus intends that his ministry of peace will go out. Now, what is the paradigm that we need to use for this generous giving and simple living? The paradigm that Jesus gives is in verse 9. He says that the paradigm is that it has been freely given to you, so freely give. The paradigm of grace. God has bestowed his resources upon you. And our generosity should reflect the generosity of the Father. You know, the more we enjoy the generosity of the Father in our walk with him every day, and in our walk with the rest of the community, the more we enjoy being generous. generosity and simplicity. But now as we preach the gospel, Jesus is very certain that this does not mean that your great motives and the way you conduct yourself is going to be received well by everyone. It is going to be received by some, but not by everyone. There will be pushback. There will be a cost to be paid. There will be pushback, there will be opposition, there will be persecution. Take a look at verse 16. Jesus says, "See, I'm sending you as sheep in the midst of wolves." Just notice the viciousness and brutality of that picture. You know, I don't have experience with wolves, thank God for that. But dogs, when they get into fights, you know, they have no mercy on the other creature, right? Often you hear the dog and the cat fighting outside your home in the middle of the night. What happens at the end of it? The cat is dead, the dog is gone. Sorry. Don't get your cats into trouble. Sorry. Cats are quite intelligent, right? They are. Sheep, on the other hand, are the stupidest of creatures. They can't think for themselves well. They need someone to help them, right? And Jesus says, "I'm sending you like sheep in the midst of wolves." What's Jesus' point? Jesus is saying that, you won't outsmart them. Don't just try to get smarter and somehow do it. Jesus says that it is going to be a vicious and brutal battle as you witness to the goodness of Jesus Christ. Jesus' point is that as we proclaim Him, it's going to be hard. There will be pushback. And where will the pushback come from? Verse 17, he says, "Beware of men, for they will deliver you over to courts and flog you in their synagogues." That is organized religion pushing back. And then he says, "And you will be dragged before the governors and kings for my sake to bear witness before them and the Gentiles." This is the pushback of the state. Then it gets worse, verses 21 and 22, he says, "Brother will betray brother and deliver over to death, and the father his child. Children will rise against parents and have them put to death, and you will be hated for my name's sake." That is the opposition from one's own family. We live in times when opposition from organized religion and government sectors, the ruling sectors, are very viciously at play against the proclamation of the gospel. And the whole country is standing and watching this. Why are people so opposed to the good news of Jesus? It is because Jesus says that when we proclaim this, we are proclaiming the kingdom of God, which means we are saying that you are not the owners, you are the tenants. And no one likes to be a tenant. You would like to be an owner who is in control. And Jesus says that all of you are tenants, you and me and the world out there. So that makes people uncomfortable. It detaches people from the thrones of their lives. There's a sense of loss of control. It stops the powerful from leveraging their power to selfish gain. It stops the wealthy from hoarding resources to disadvantage the poor. It stops the religious in their self-righteousness by declaring them as sinful as the rest of the world. That makes people very uncomfortable. And persecution is the natural outcome of that. You know, there are these two accusations that we keep hearing regularly about Christianity. One is that they are bigoted because they proclaim exclusive claims of Jesus Christ, and two, that they are converting everyone. Think about it. If someone came and said, "I found the cure for cancer," which people have not been able to find so far, and he says, "You know, I got it right, and the rest of the whole world got it wrong," what do you say to that guy? Do you go and say you're bigoted? No. He could be lying, Very well, he could be doing that. But he could be telling the truth. So you need to test his claims. But you don't call him a bigot. You know, when you proclaim the exclusive claims of Jesus Christ, that's what's going to happen. It's not bigotry. It's proclaiming the truth for people to come and taste and see. My friend, if you have not come and tasted the goodness of Jesus Christ, may I welcome you to come and taste his goodness and see if he is worthy a master to follow. And the second thing that you keep hearing is that you people convert. Don't convert anyone. And when you're saying that, you're essentially saying that you think that Jesus is the only way to the Father or to heaven. But I don't think that Jesus is the only way, right? So you don't say that Jesus is the only way and ask people to accept that. And what are you essentially saying? You're saying that believe that what the Christians are saying is a lie, and so embrace my standpoint. What is that? You're asking the Christian to convert to your belief. Anyone who is convinced about the power of the gospel will testify. If that is true, if that is life-changing, why won't you talk about that? Now, coming back to the disciples, opposition will come from various quarters. What do they do when opposition comes? Jesus says, be as wise as serpents and innocent as doves. Employ every bit of wisdom within your reach. If it means advocacy, get that going. We're immensely thankful for Christian organizations like Alliance Defending Freedom, who are fighting against the vicious opposition to the gospel of Jesus Christ. I would like to encourage us to be participant in work like that. Be wise as serpents. Employ every wisdom possible. And Jesus says that when pushing back on opposition doesn't work, flee. And there is no intrinsic goodness in just staying there and then saying, well, I don't have resources, but I'll just stay here and be unwise about it. Jesus, flee from that situation. Employ wisdom. But at the same time, be innocent as doves. Don't attack evil with evil. Don't attack viciousness with viciousness. And that is going to come at a great cost. How do we do this? This is just extraordinary things that Jesus is asking us to do, right? Jesus says, I know this will scare you. But verse 19, Jesus says, do not be anxious. How can I not be anxious? Because there is a confidence. Jesus says in verse 19 that when you are faced with this opposition, the Spirit of the Father will, it will not be you who speak, but the Spirit of the Father speaking through you. It is God who will be with you. He will be working through you. He will give you the words to say. He'll direct your paths in that moment. You're not alone. You will always have his help. And what's even more amazing is that towards the end of this chapter, Jesus says, your own master, that is me, has been treated that way. Isn't it good to be treated like your master was treated? Jesus is inviting us into a privilege of walking with him. But why should that be a privilege? You know why? Because Jesus went through the persecution to its fullest extent. It was so great that no one was with him. Everyone left him. His own disciples deserted him. In fact, what is even more heartbreaking is that on the cross he cried and said, my God, why have you forsaken me? I'm alone here. Why did Jesus do that? It's so that you and I can have the assurance that when you and I go through these situations, you're never alone. You're never alone. the Spirit of the Father will testify from within you. He will give you the boldness to face opposition and persecution. He'll give you the strength to say, though world may leave me, still I will follow. No turning back, no turning back. Jesus is bringing his kingdom of shalom into this world and calling you and me to be participants in it, together with him. What a privilege. Let's close in prayer. Our loving Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. Lord, you invite us into this privilege of being your co-laborers in bringing shalom into our broken world. Lord, left to us, we'll be scared to proclaim it verbally, to do the acts of mercy towards the world that is broken and suffering. Lord, would you give us strength by your Holy Spirit? Jesus, help us to know that when we are going through the most challenging of these circumstances, that we are not alone. Because you were alone on the cross, that we will never be alone. You will never leave us nor forsake us. In that comfort, we rest our hearts. In Jesus' name, we ask this prayer. Amen.
Church, in response to the preaching of the word, let's all rise and sing, I will follow you.
When the sea is calm and all is right, when I feel your favor flood my life, even in the good I'll follow you. Even in the good I'll follow you. When the boat is tossed upon the waves, when I wonder if you keep me safe, even in the storms I'll follow you. Even in the storms I'll follow you. And I believe everything that you say you are. I believe, I have seen your unchanging heart. In the good things, in the hardest part, I believe and I will follow you. I believe and I will follow you. When I see the wicked prospering, when I feel I have no voice to sing, even in the want I'll follow you. Even in the want I'll follow you. I believe everything that you say you are. I believe I've seen your unchanging heart. In the good things, in the hardest part, I believe and I will follow you. I believe and I will follow you. When I find myself so far from home, and you lead me somewhere I don't want to go, even in my death I'll follow you. Even in my death I'll follow you. When I come to end this race I run, receive the prize that Christ has won. I will be with you in paradise. I will be with you in paradise. I believe everything that you say you are. Good
Please be seated. When you lead me somewhere that I don't want to go, even in the death I will follow you. Even in the death I will follow you. Such bold statements. How do we make the statements? We can make this statement only when we know that there is someone else who followed us to death, who followed us all the way to hell and picked us up from there, who saw us in our helpless estate and restored us to life eternal. My friends, on the night the Lord Jesus was betrayed, that's what you saw happening in the garden, at the table, on the cross. He took the bread, and when he had given thanks, he said, "This is my body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And likewise, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and you drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." You proclaim how he pursued you, and he pursues the sinners of this world until he comes. My friend, if you put your faith in Jesus, if you have been baptized into the body of Jesus Christ, may I invite you to come and partake in this table with joy, because your Savior, your Shepherd, has pursued you even to death. If you have not yet put your faith in Christ, if you have not yet been baptized, would you rather look at the prayers that are printed at the back of your worship guide and meditate upon these. Ask God to give life to your heart, to join you to Christ the Good Shepherd, to help you see his goodness that pursues you even now. Also, there are verses that are printed and kept in the bread tray. Why don't you take one of these and meditate on this? This is God's word. And let God's word bring life to your hearts. But if you have put your faith already in Jesus and been baptized, come partake in this table with joy. The Savior, the Shepherd, pursues you still. I request the elders to come and distribute the elements to us. Let's all hold on to the elements till everyone receives them and then partake in them together.
To see the dawn of the darkest day, Christ on the road to Calvary, tried by sinful men, torn and beaten there, nailed to the cross of love. Lift the power of the cross. Christ became sin for us. Took the blame. Bore the wrath we stand forgiven at the cross. Oh, to see the pain written on your face, bearing the awesome weight of sin, every bitter thought, every evil deed, crowning your blood-stained brow. Is the power of the cross. Christ became for us, took the blame for the wrath we stand forgiven at the cross. Now the daylight flees, now the ground beneath wakes as its maker bows his head. Curtain torn in two, dare a race to life, finish the victory cry. 'Tis the power of the cross. Christ became sin for us, took the blame, bore the wrath we stand forgiven at the my name written in the wounds, for through your suffering I am free. Death is crushed to death, life is mine to live. Won through your selfless love. Is the power of the cross. Son of God, slain for us. What a love, what a cost we stand.
Brothers and sisters, the atoning sacrifice of Jesus, his body was broken for you and his blood shed for you. Receive them with joy and thanksgiving. Shall we all rise to sing the song of thanksgiving as our children come to collect cups?
A mighty fortress is our God, a bulwark never failing. Our helper, he amidst a flood of waters is prevailing. For still our ancient foe doth seem to work us woe. His craft and power are great, and armed with cruel hate. On earth is not his equal. Did we in our own strength confine, our striving would be losing. Were not the right man on our side, the man of God's own choosing. Dost ask who that may be? Christ Jesus, it is he, the Lord of hosts is name, from age to age the same. And he must win the battle. And though this world with devils filled should threaten to undo us, we will not fear, for God hath willed his triumph through us. The Prince of Darkness grim, we tremble not for him. His rage we can endure, for lo, his truth is sure. One little word shall fail, a mighty fortress, a rock unfailing, the King of glory. Powers, no thanks to him abided. The Spirit and the gifts are ours through him who with us sided. Let goods and kindred go, this mortal life also, the body they may kill, God's truth abideth still. His kingdom is forever.
A mighty fortress.
A mighty fortress. A rock unfailing. The King of glory forever. Amen.
thank you so much for joining us for this worship service. A quick announcement, right after the service, there are a few muffins at the back. This is from Roshni. It's Ben's birthday today. So we'll sing happy birthday to him after the benediction. And also, it was Pia's birthday last Sunday. So this is a combined celebration of that. So please partake in that and give Ben a tight hug. Receive the benediction before we close the service. Finally, brothers, rejoice. Aim for restoration. Comfort one another. Agree with one another. Live in peace. And the God of love and peace will be with you. And God's people respond saying, thanks be to God. Amen. Thank you, friends. You're dismissed. Yeah, happy birthday.
Birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Ben. Happy birthday to you.
Did the nation be glad?